Hello, my name is Casper Stanley. I'm here at Copenhagen Suborbitals to take a look at the new BPM25 rocket engine and the Spica rocket. So let's head inside and talk to them, see what it's all about.
I'm Jørgen, I'm chairman of Copenhagen Suborbitals.
I'm Christian, I'm also a board member of CS.
We are aiming at being the first amateurs to send a human being into space and back in reusable condition, as we say.
The human is reusable. Wonderful. And we have a rocket engine right behind us here. Like disassembled, a little bit disassembled.
First of all, we're aiming at the big rockets. Mm-hmm. We have a chart behind us here. Talking about the big rocket we are building for a manned space flight. It's just meant to fly to above the Kármán line and return on the sea. And we need a very big rocket engine. We have decided to build this big rocket in a clustered configuration with several rocket engines inside. And this is the first one we have built. It's called the BPM25, which is a 25 kilonewtons engine. And we've just finished all these parts.
All right, so that is the BPM25 rocket engine that they're building, a little bit downscaled from their previous BPM100 design. But as you can see in this cluster configuration, that leaves a little bit more room to get to know the engine with like producing more of them. It also reminds me a little bit of the, of course, Saturn V engine layout, but that's a little bit bigger. We could also definitely see the Spica rocket utilize single axis gimbaling like the Alpha rocket by Firefly, which is a compromise in control authority, but can be a little bit easier to manufacture and program for, I imagine. And weight is probably a factor too, because this is all just a fight with the tyranny of the rocket equation. But that all goes into the Spica rocket, which will take this single human on ascent in a flight profile that's kind of similar to the new Shepherds, but it could not fundamentally be more different from the billionaire funded Blue Origin versus this little crowdfunded rocket shop in Copenhagen. But with that all in mind, let's take a deeper dive into the BPM25.
It's basically a common regenerative cooled engine running on liquid oxygen and alcohol.
Okay, so regeneratively cooled, that means that the ethanol, the fuel, is running up the side of the engine to cool the engine.
You see here in a second, we have an outer wall here and an inner wall. This is the combustion chamber inside here. And then we have a space between the walls. The alcohol is flowing up and cooling the inner side. Inside of the rocket engine. Then it is entered into the rocket engine and is combusted inside here.
So you're actually using all of the, you're running all of the alcohol through the engine there to cool it.
Exactly.
And then all of the oxygen is just running in the top of the engine.
The top of it, yes.
Okay.
It's made of common construction steel, and Christian knows a lot more about why we're using construction steel instead of like Inconel.
One of the reasons is that it's much more easy to work with. It's much more forgiving if you have a simple manufacturing technology. It's availability. It's the price of the material, because all of these exotic materials are also extremely expensive. And actually, the performance of the engine is not so high that we cannot solve the problems with ordinary construction steel.
And then we are milling it on a 3D mill, three-axis mill. We have reconstructed ourselves, and that's actually Peter Scott that has something to do with that.
The milling machine is a almost 40-year-old milling machine that we purchased. Well used, but still in good condition. It had a very old control systems that we ended up ripping out and replaced all of the electronics in it with more modern components. So now we're actually able to do three-axis milling. We can actually push it all the way up to five-axis, which we need for some of the parts.
So speaking about all these different machines that they're customizing for their needs, we started talking about how they're also automating. And as you'll see in just a little bit, they built this custom welding machine to weld the inside of the tanks in places that are impossible to reach. And they had to build a similar welding machine for the engine because there's also some tight areas in there that it's hard to reach. So I was wondering if this is something that they only really had to do on this rocket versus their previous missions, and how it's related to the scale and having a human fly on it. So did you do this kind of automation even for the previous rockets, or are you especially like having to do that because this is another class?
We have increased this automation a lot in Spica because we need to achieve a higher level of quality. And also the amount of weldings are also much larger. That means that the chance of making an error is simply larger. So in order to take the human factor out of the welding, we have introduced all this automation.
We have this the tanks for the speaker rocket. There's actually 1 meter in diameter, and we have to find a way to weld them by ourselves because we didn't have the money. A robot that could weld this tank, and at the same time a robot that welded the tank from the inside through a small hole. The tanks are completed and pressure tested, and we are right now we have installed it in our test stand. We have built a new test stand. When we are building a rocket engine, it's not just the rocket engine that we're building. We need to build all the equipment to test the rocket engine and parts of it at the same time. That is water test to test flow characteristics through the injector, test stand for hot firing, and we've built all that parallel to this development.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of things going on behind the curtain before we end up with a functional rocket engine.
So there you go, they've built and customized all these machines to create the engines and the propellant tanks, which are all now in various states of being completed or works in progress. They're also working on the capsule and the nose cone, and inside that nose cone it's got to be a couple of parachutes so you can actually survive, I guess. Let's touch on the latter half of this mission, the re-entry phase and the parachutes.
One of the things people often forget when we are talking rocketry, that is the descent phase. Yeah. This organization, we have, I think, 65 people working on the rocket and the rocket engine and so on, and we have one man working on the parachutes, sewing them and finding out how to deploy them. And as I volunteered in working on the nose cone, I thought, well, that's might be easy, studying the trajectory and the attitudes of the capsule and the possible errors and the way it orients itself and so on is a lot more complex than you would imagine.
It's not just a simple nose. It has to have the correct geometry and then also has to separate cleanly and at the correct time.
Timing.
Yeah.
Because when you're coming down here, you are accelerating faster and faster down here. When you're releasing the capsule up here, you are actually tumbling.
Right.
And you have to reorient the capsule, but you have to know how it's oriented so that it just don't tumble around. But when we come back here, at some point in the descent phase, we have to put up the balut to stabilize the capsule and maybe slow it a bit down. How do we know when to do that?
Yeah.
That is a trick question because we don't want to deploy the parachute too early because then we could risk that the wires would entangle around the capsule and that would be a catastrophe.
While there's no like aerodynamic forces on it, it would just get tangled.
Yes.
Yeah.
And if you do it a bit too late, the drag force from the atmosphere will be so hard that the balut would rip apart or burn up in a few seconds.
We can look at the data from accelerometers on board the capsule, and there we can actually see when we start hitting a bit of atmosphere because we can measure a little bit of drag.
Okay.
It's not much, but it should be measurable.
So it wouldn't be pre-timed, it would be based on the active measurements of the atmosphere. Okay, that's interesting.
It will actually also tell us in which direction we're hitting the atmosphere. So even if we're hitting it sideways, we can see that.
Yeah.
And deploy the balut in the right direction back.
That's wild.
Later on, we have this. We would like to deploy the parachutes. And Mads Steenfat, the guy who is sewing these parachutes himself,
the single guy working on re-entry.
We have to sew them ourselves because we haven't got the money to buy parachutes. He told me one day that I'm not sure the balut will survive. He said, and I was like, what? So. To be sure, we have to have another phase we haven't drawn anything about. That's a pilot chute phase where we take out three pilot chutes that later on will drag out the main chutes. G-load could be a problem. We don't, not the launch itself, but when it capsule descends and meet the denser parts of the atmosphere and with the balloon and so on, the G-forces can be quite high.
Yeah.
5 or 6 G's maximum, but still.
Which is fine, but like it's on the limit of...
It's not funny.
So that's the whole, that's the Spica mission, that's the final goal of Copenhagen Suborbitals, launching a human into space. Thank you so much.
And we all know where.